My dear friends, now Pradyumna moved on to Sri Shailam following the beautiful horse. Then he moved to Pampa and then to Mahendrachal. He bowed down to sage Parashuram who hosted them and feasted all soldiers with 8-course meal by his yoga power. Now they moved on. King Brihadbhanu from Utkal state fought ferociously but was defeated, and then he paid tributes. They saw Mithila of King Dhriti, the father of Prince Bahulashu. All homes were like temples, all citizens were cosmic concerts, and all sites, all whether were heavenly. Prince Pradyumna was very impressed. He could not dare to fight or ask for tribute from such an angelic and saintly state. Pradyumna assumed the form of a holy man, and Uddhava became his disciple. They appeared in the royal assembly. The king rose up and warmly welcomed these illustrious guests to Arghyampadyam and all that, and said, with full of feelings he spoke, Adyame safalam janma mandiram vishadi kritam devarshi pitra sarve santushtaya gate dvai. O great guest of mine, you are so illustrious. My life is a success. My birth is a success. My abode, my residence had been sanctified by your footsteps. And all my departed ancestors are liberated now since you came to my home. Then Prince Pradyumna, in the form of a holy man, said, O King, you are blessed, your city is blessed, your citizens are also blessed, all are highly evolved. And King Bahulashu said, Holy Sire, this city is not mine, citizens too are not mine, all belong to the Almighty Lord. Pradyumna said, Lord God has incarnated at present as Lord Krishna. His messenger Pradyumna is traveling around the world inviting all to come to his reverend Lord in Dwarkapuri. How come he hasn't come to you? And King Dhriti said, One who is his messenger must be omniscient and omnipresent like he himself. So his holiness, he is here, there and everywhere. Is that so? Pradyumna said, then could you please show me, like Prahlad of antiquity, get him to make an appearance before me. Then only I feel you have honored me. The king had a great challenge. The king sat down quietly and right then and there on a kusha grass seat and remembered the Lord, and tears of devotion wetted his face, fields of devotion adorned his limbs, and he said, If my devotion to God is real, if God recognizes me and his devotee, then by the power of this truth, let the Lord's messenger appear before me. Then the king recited it over and over with utmost emotion, And immediately, my dear friends, what happened? Automatically, the holy man's dress, holy man's outfit, Dr. Dyumna, immediately flew away without his trying or putting them off. It just flew away into the sky, and right then, in his princely form, stout, beautiful, looking like Krishna, Pradyumna appeared in his original form and smilingly blessed the king, and the king embraced him, and prince invited him to Dwarka in Yajna. The sacrificial horse proceeded on and on. It was captured by King Jarasandha of Giridhar. At once he attacked Pradyumna with a huge army. Sambha fought ferociously, breaking his chariot. Jarasandha rode an elephant. It picked up Sambha with its trunk and hurled and threw him away. Gada came and dashed his mace on his head. Then angry Jarasandha caught hold of Gada and threw him in the sky. As he fell on the earth, he too lifted Jarasandha and reeled him around and around and around and threw him in the sky. As he fell down on the earth, he began to fight more dangerously. Pradyumna began to fight. Great battle. Right then Balaramji appeared in the battlefield. He enlarged his plow, got Jarasandha by his neck and dragged him, then dashed his plow on his head. Bleeding profusely, he fell on the ground unconscious. Then his son came and offered plentiful gifts. He admitted his father in the hospital and in emergency ward and feasted the army, my dear friend. Army now marched on. They visited Gaya, Prayag. At the union place, they donated all kinds of gifts to the wise men and poor and the beggars. The army moved on. No other king was there to confront. And they heard about Jarasandha's defeat, they all gave tributes. Suddenly, King of Bindu State came. He invited all the princes, in Swayambara ceremony of his 18 daughters. There were 18 transparent glass jars filled with water hanging in the space on a thin string between tall poles of about 30 feet high. He declared, the winner will be he who will be able to pierce the jar fully from down to the upper edge. The arrow will enter the jar so delicately that not a single drop of water could drip. Arrow must stay stuck in between both edges. People were shocked. How can that be possible? First, Prince Pradyumna stood up to meet the challenge. He picked up a shining arrow on the string of his bow. He pulled it all the way up to his ear and targeted the glass jar and shot. Wind drop silence, thousands of people watching, just staring. In the split second, the assembly of the youngsters and warriors resounded with joy. They saw arrow has pierced the jar from one edge to another, and it's staying stuck. Not a single drop of water fell. Thus, one by one, 18 jars were shot successfully by all brothers of Pradyumna. The king was hilarious with joy. 18 princes came among great song and music they garlanded the 18 sons of Lord Krishna. Festivity continued for days. Now they came to Vrindavan. The gopis and gopas ran down and saw 18 Krishna-looking youths. Uddhava guided them and introduced each and every one of Vrindavan. He taught them philosophy of Mahabhava. Hearing the wisdom of Vrindavan, love of Sri Krishna dazzled up brilliantly, and each and every hero began to prostrate to Nanda Yashoda and Vrishabhanuji Maharaj, each gopi. And when they saw Sri Radha, they just fainted in deep devotion to her. They strolled in and through the bushes and groves in the bank of Yamuna, where the Lord has had his sweet pastimes. Balim chananda rajaya datva natva puna puna kai pujitai kati dinai idobu nanda gokule. Offering the best tributes they won at the feet of Nandana and Yashoda Mam and the gopis. They offered and offered and offered and everything. And then when they were empty-handed, they marched further. The horse proceeded. They offered all their wealth and the dowry of love. Love offering to Mother Yashoda and Nanda Maharaj, prostrating the couple over and over, they marched further on their mission. Now the sacrificial horse came to Hastinapur, the capital of the Kurus. Uddhavji approached King Dhritarashtra. He was sitting on the throne surrounded by Bhishma, Karna, Dronacharya, Kripacharya, Kurisrava, Balik and Shakuni, Dushasana, Duryodhana and Ashwatthama and all that. As soon as he gave Pradyumna's message to pay tribute and come to Yajna, they became furious. They said aloud, "Look at these Yadavas, we avoided their being kings, so they prospered, now they want to climb up on our head. Let's battle up and mail them to hell." Prince Pradyumna was informed, and he was furious. A fearful fight began. Pradyumna fought with Duryodhan, Aniruddha fought with Bhishma, Bhanu fought with Drona, Madhu fought with Karna, Purisrava fought with Kritavarma. Pradyumna shot an arrow which took Duryodhana up in the air with his chariot, and hurled it around and around and around and around, then dashed him down on the ground. After a long battle, Prince Pradyumna did it again. He threw Duryodhan up in the sky with his chariot. Then as he was falling down, he shot another arrow, then another arrow, and then another and another, pushed him to his palace, and dashed him in the yard where his blind father was sitting. Duryodhana fell down unconscious, vomiting lots of blood. Bhishma, Drona and all others were shot to end down. Suddenly there appeared Balaramji and Krishnaji illuminating all directions. Great jubilations in the Yadavas. Pradyumna and all great warriors bowed down to Krishna and Balaram. All Kauravas, chiefs, his sons and generals have made us to lick the dust in the battlefield. Now Supremo himself has come, both of them have come. So Duryodhana ran, folded hands, and prostrated at the feet of Balaramji. "Oh, my mess master, forgive me, forgive me. I didn't know you. I am just a baby, your baby." Great Balaramji smiled and said, "Now you knew me by a heavy kick. I am glad you do understand some language, the language of the king. All Kauravas welcomed the Yadavas. They worshipped Krishna and Balram, offered lots of tributes. Yadavas took leave and went to see the Pandavas. Shankaranda vinadena brahma ghoshena venubhi pushpavarsham prakurvadhi indra prasthani vasivhi Ramakrishna parishadya dorbhyam raja yudhishthira paramam nirvritim lebhe yogi vananda sampluta pradyumnadya Hari Sutta Pranimu Sri Yudhishthiram. Conches and drums and clarinets resounded on the welcome of Krishna and Balram with the Yadavas. Multiple flower showers and arati continued on. Embracing Krishna and Balram hard with great love, King Yudhishthir entered transcendental consciousness like yogis, my dear friends. All sons of Lord Krishna bowed down to King Yudhishthir, and Draupadi Devi, and Arjuna, and Bhimsen, and all brothers came wearing big smiles on their faces. They enjoyed a few days. Then Krishna and Balram left for Dwarka. A week later, when Yadava army proceeded, Yudhishthira, concerned of safety of Pradyumna, asked his brother, great archer Arjuna, to accompany Prince Pradyumna, and he did. Next, they came to Trigarth. King Susharma surrendered with tributes. They went to Kashmir, Gandhar, and Greece. King Chanda, the son of Kalyavan, was furious. He announced, he wants dreadful revenge of killing of his father. He attacked with 10 million soldiers. Prince Pradyumna invited all the army and announced, anyone who will present me the head of Chanda will be coronated as commander-in-chief of our army. Arjuna took up the challenge. Single-handed Arjuna entered the Yavana's army and in the Greece, near the Athens, and created a dreadful devastation. Wherever he went, thousands fell dead. Chanda shot him with a spear. Arjuna broke it down in pieces. Then he broke his bow one after another and another and another. Hundreds and thousands bow he used, but Arjuna broke them all. Arjuna shot his elephant. Head broke, blood poured out, it knelt down and fainted. Chanda jumped down and attacked on him with a large sword. Arjuna bore it on his shield and then sliced his head off with a single shot of arrow. Then he placed that head on another arrow and shot. It came all the way and quietly placed the head near the feet of Pradyumna. Drums resounded, flowers showered, and Arjuna was coronated as commander-in-chief of the Yadava army. Thus the whole of Europe surrendered to Dwarka Empire. Now the horse arrived at Shonitpur, my dear friend, Shonitpur of Banasur. Banasur was furious. He prepared to fight, my dear friend. Lord Shiva appeared. He scolded and stopped him. He ordered him to pay tribute, and he did. Then there was war with Kuber. He was showering death from his Pushpaka airplane. Veerbhadra and Gad started throwing each other into the sky, one after another and another. Swami Kartike hurled and shot his spear, which dashed Aniruddha with a chariot miles away, killing soldiers all around. Samba shot his tongue and arrow and pierced all his limbs. Ganeshji came. He showered dreadful destruction all around. Aniruddha now assumed the form of a huge cat and fell before the mouse which was carrying Ganeshji, and the mouse trembled and ran away. Cat also chased him all over. Kuber shot and huge clouds covered the whole sky. It rained and rained, flooding all. Pradyumna whispered, Krishna's mantra, he whispered, wrote it on the tip of his arrow and shot. Like lightning it flew in the sky and dispersed the darkness of Maya of Gurjaka. Kubera was scared. He ran back to his city and came with tributes of 100 philosopher's stone that is called Paras, a stone or a gem with which if you touch an iron it turns into a gold. Then he brought basket full of pearls and diamonds and sapphires and so many things. And he brought a beautiful airplane and 100 jars of nectar and millions of valuables. Now, my dear friends, they came to Pragjyotishpur. Bhaumasur's son was the ruler. He welcomed them and offered tributes. Banasur Dvivid, that Vanara Dvivid came and started destroying much portion of the army. Pradyumna shot an arrow. It pierced Dvivid one end to another and hurled him in the sky and dashed him down in Kishkindha. He fainted down. The arrow returned back in Pradyumna's quiver. Now the army proceeded to King Purushvarsh. They landed on Rangavalli Puram at the valley of Kimput Mountain. King Purushas were thrilled. King Subbahu surrendered. They exchanged gifts and honors. Long ago, during Sagar Manthan age, when the jar of nectar arose, Lord Vishnu glanced at it. Drop of his pleasure fell, and there from what they was born Tulsi. From there Tulsi was born. He named it as Rangavalli and planted it here in the valley of Hemakut Mountain. Now it is a huge, gigantic tree, and my capital is known by its name. All warriors came for darshan. They offered respect to the holy tree. Then they had darshan of Hanumanji and Arishtasen, who came to worship Lord Sri Sitaram. As they were returning through a thick forest, a huge dragon attacked them. All 10 sons of Krishna shot arrows and broke it into pieces. Soon a denizen rose from the dead. He thanked them up and said he is Sumati, a brother of Ashtashena Gandharva. He used to come with his brother to listen Ramayana from Hanumanji. One day during his discourse, Hanumanji was entranced in love of Sri Sitaram. Out of fun, he made a sound of his. Hanumanji resumed his katha, but he cursed him by his offense. He was destined to become a dragon for insulting the katha. Upon regret, Hanumanji assured his deliverance when cut into pieces by sons of Lord Krishna in copper age. Sumati rose into the sky in an airplane and went to his planet. Army proceeded further. They came to the city of Vasanta Tilaka. King Sringara Tilak came to fight. After an hour fight, the king surrendered. They came to Harivarsh in the lap of Mount Nishad. Suddenly huge vultures came and started swallowing horses and elephants of the army. Prince Pradyumna shot Garudastra. Vultures were chased away. Soon King Shubhanga joined them. He led them to Dasharanamochan Tirth. Prahladji was worrying. He could not serve his father. How could he be free from Ranamukti? Pitradin. The parents are dead. Lord Nrsimha's compassionate eyes dropped tears, and this pond came into existence. He blessed it to be a deliverer from 10 big debts, such as parental debt, spousal debt, preceptor's debt, refugee debts, and several others. They all took bath in the holy pond, worshipped and offered charities, and wandered in the beautiful Nishad mountain. Next they went to Kuru Varsha, then they swam in the Bhadra Ganga river. As they came out of water, they saw a new horse released by King Gunakar. His son Veeradhanva was following it. As the Yadavas held it, Uddhavji went to the prince and bowed down to him. He explained to him the situation and requested to help Dwarka Empire to conduct the ceremony. The prince said, "My father is greater than even Indra. He cannot pay tribute to anybody. Lord Varaha has blessed him for his invincibility. Therefore, leave our horse alone, or let there be battle." There was fearful battle. Finally, Prince Purnamas fell with Veeradhanva down, vomiting lots of blood. Great panic arose in the city. Sage Vamadeva explained to the king the greatness of Lord Krishna. He came with his tributes and made friends. The party came to Hiranmaya Varsha, my dear friends. There were large numbers of vanaras from the race of Neel. They were ordered to stay there by Lord Rama himself after the Rama Ramana War. As soon as they saw Pradyumna's army, they just made a surprise attack. They wounded thousands of soldiers and bound chariots, horses, elephants with their tails, and hurled them up above in the sky. Even Arjuna was not spared. He was thrown in the space. By doing so, they insulted Hanumanji, who is always residing in the flag. He became furious. Now he jumped out and started binding all of them and dashing them on the ground. He bound them all in his tail and started dashing them. They were shocked who this was of such an enormous strength. They recognized their old bosom friend. They snuggled up in loving emotions. They kissed his tail, his feet, and bowed down. After a heartfelt reception, they left for Chitravan. Army came to Makar Parvat Valley. Millions of bumblebees attacked them. Prince Pradyumna perspired, but he dispersed them off, shooting pavan astra, a wind arm. Then came to a country, a string where all people had horns on their head. Soon the army came to the bank of Chandrakanta River. The country was heavenly. People so beautiful, almost moonshine face. Prince Pradyumna asked King Devasukha the mystery behind